We're just back from CBEC. Yay! This is your CBEC choir. They've been rehearsing 1 hour a day for 5 days, so 5 hours total. And this is our program today. We're going to kick it off with a song called One Love. And Leo's going to do the lead there. Please welcome Carl Anthony.
It's so good to see you. So good to see you. Did you miss me? I missed you too, but I tell you, we had an amazing time at CBEC. Okay, let's just do a four-word prayer, shall we? Thumbs up. Here we go. I can do anything. Let's all stand up. Come on, here we go. Ready? I can do anything. Oh, you've got it. Look at that person next to you and say, you're doing good. It's all right. It's going to be okay. All right, band. 1, 2, 3, begin.
I can do anything.
Oh, do you feel it? See, I feel it.
I feel it.
Good morning. If someone tells you it's a waste of time, don't even try it. Don't be fooled, my friend. Believe in you. You can do it. You want the truth. You can do anything. Together. I can do anything. Come on, side, other side.
right, how many of you are feeling it, right? You feel it? Let's go, let's go. Here we go.
How will you ever know if you'll succeed unless you try it? You'll never know for yourself until you buy it. You want the truth, you can do anything. Together,
I can do anything. I can do anything. I can do anything. I can do anything.
Do you wanna do something? Do what you always wanted. Do you wanna be something? Be who you always wanted. Do you wanna love something? Take every chance that's given. Do you wanna say something? Say it, say it.
I can do anything. I can do anything. I can do anything. I can do anything.
And you know what we ought to do? Let's say we instead of I, all right? You ready? 1, 2, 3, go!
We can do anything. We can do anything. We can do anything. We can do anything.
Woo! How about that choir, huh?
Well, I said at first service, and I'll say it again, it may be Bruce, because Bruce is, you know, sound engineer today, or it might be the choir, or it might be you, but you guys sounded great. I mean, it really sounded good. Yeah. We kind of work in themes here, just in case you're new, because oftentimes an idea takes some cultivation, some, it can't just be said in one fell swoop. And so, we are finishing up our series on recovery, recovering our innocence, our worthiness, our basic goodness, recovering that. It was covered up. Well, it didn't go anywhere. It was covered up. And so we've been uncovering it for a while. But now we're shifting. I feel like I it's almost September. It's time to go back to school. So let's go back to basics. So our theme now is basic ideas of the science of mind. And kind of like, so what is it we teach anyway? And for me, it's definitely going back to basics. It's like studying color theory again, or studying balance, or any of those basic concepts from which any art form is built. You have to have some basics, or you'd have to have basics in architecture, in just gravity. I can't believe I'm going to say this because it's being recorded, but... It's important to go back to basics. I was once married to this gentleman. I've been married to a lot of gentlemen, but this particular gentleman had been a choreographer, and he just didn't understand why people couldn't leap in the air and hold it and then land on the beat. Something basic about gravity just didn't appear to him. It wasn't leaping through the air. It was leap, hold. 2, 3, 4, down 2, 3, 4. Just didn't, yeah, anyway, so basics are very important for every art form. And there's an art to the way we think. And this is very Buddhist, because in Buddhism, it's often studying the mind and where it puts us and what it does to us. The Buddha said, our current situations are the results of our past thoughts. So it's important to study how we think and what might be happening to our thoughts and our thinking. Our founder, Ernest Holmes, who wrote this book, said we don't tell people what to think. We're not going to tell you what to think. We're not going to tell you how you should believe. We're just going to tell you what your thinking does, and then you make your own choices. So these are the basics. But before we get to the basics, which was my purpose for creating this talk, And then CBAC happened. So you get two talks for the time of one today. Because CBAC always shifts me if I really pay attention. Many years ago, I'd say about maybe 20 years ago or 15 years ago, I don't remember the time, but what my intention going into CBAC was, wouldn't it be great for us to create heaven? Because before that time, we'd gotten together and had camp, but it wasn't necessarily always heavenly. We always knew it would kind of shake out in the end, but sometimes getting from the Monday to Friday was fraught with all sorts of interesting things called drama. And I just didn't want it that way. I wanted it to be heaven. And I don't know how we created heaven. I really don't. But I think the intention to have heaven and then doing just tiny little shifts started to create a heavenly experience. And heaven is always in your head. And it means harmony and rightness and a sense of this is okay. And what's hell is a sense of this isn't okay. And we can all go to both of those places multiple times in a week. But wouldn't it be great to cultivate heaven? So honestly, I think that we're getting there and continue to get there. And I think that the most heavenly experience that we all get to learn from is our teen and young adults program. Because they seem to be having a heavenly experience. So anyone that was there this year, would you say that the teens and the young adults are having a heavenly experience? Yeah. Yeah, they definitely are. And yet, stuff is still happening. So how is it that they're creating heaven? This is important to study because this is why people study. You don't have to learn everything by yourself. You can actually study someone else and go, I'm not doing that. Or you can study someone else and go, I want to do that. That's why I think we're on this planet together. There are enough planets in the universe that if we could grow better by ourselves, we would have a planet to ourselves. But, and I'm not saying other people don't, but the way we incarnated, my guess is that we knew we would evolve faster together. So we learn from one another. And so this is what I learned from watching the teens and the young adults. They are consciously creating a sangha, which is also very Buddhist. The Buddha said, I will take refuge in the Buddha, which meant consciousness. You see, he wasn't the Buddha like his, he wasn't born Buddha. Buddha was his title because he reached that level of consciousness. We take refuge in the consciousness. We take refuge in the Dharma, which means law. And we take refuge in the Sangha, which is spiritual community. And I noticed that the teens are especially taking refuge in their spiritual community. They cultivate it. They're in it. It feeds them and they feed it. And they take refuge in it. I'm not going to repeat what I heard on the Wednesday evening because although I could because it was said to everybody. It's, you know, if you say something out loud to 200 people, it's not a secret. Just saying. Like, if you put something on Facebook, it's not a secret. But what I heard, and I won't repeat it, but what I heard is some heart-wrenching stuff. Good stuff, other stuff. Good stuff, other stuff. And some of those young people are going through stuff that I don't know how I would handle at my age. And I certainly don't know how I would have handled it at their age. And yet they seem to be growing from it, evolving in it, and getting stronger because of it. Why? Because of a sangha. People there to support them as they go through. To love them, to bless them, to be there for them as they go through. There were some aspects of sangha that I noticed in the teens, and I want to bring it to our attention. The first one is that they have a high level of acceptance. It's like, you're here, you're okay. You're here, you're okay. Not, you're here, prove yourself. You're here, who you call, who you family. You know, it's not, you're here, stand over there and we'll let you know when you're in. It's, you're here and you're in. You heard that over and over and over again. If they're there, they're in. They're embraced. You're one of us. Total acceptance. The next thing that I noticed about these young people is that they have a high level of attendance, meaning they attend. Well, they're told to, they must. But it seems to work. You don't get out. You're in it. If you're not feeling good, you attend. If you're feeling good, you attend. And then the sangha is something that cooks in the midst of that attending. So for that, it is I'm here and it's okay. The thought that went through my head last night when I wrote this was, you must be present to win. The next thing that they did, and I noticed, is that they have a high level of involvement. They're cheering each other on. They're involved in each other's life. If a teen did anything, whether it was say a prayer or anything, yeah, the whole room goes crazy. They stand up, yay! They're involved in each other and with each other. So then it's like, we're here, and we're going to make this okay. No matter what you're going through, we're here and we're going to make this okay. They talk, they listen. They talk, they listen, they incorporate. Now, how can I bring this? I had to ask myself last night, how can I bring this into the larger community? Because what if we're doing heaven so well for a week that we made it, oh, I don't know, let's do another 50 weeks. We'll have 1 week off. 1 week, no heaven. In fact, we'll just have it on, you know, I'll send you out a note. If you're signed up, I'll send you out a note ahead of time. This week will be hell. Some of you will really like it. Some of you have been waiting for this week. Please come and be grumpy. Get it all over everybody. But what if we took 1 week and made at least another 50? How would we do that? How do we do that as adults? We have to become like children. Why? You know, so many references in world religions is about the young leading us. It's not just biblical, it's other religions. You got to get outside your smarty pants adult self to experience heaven the way you know it should be, which has just been formed out of a society that doesn't want you to have a sangha. And you got to break out and break loose, or you will continually have your isolated experience that sometimes will be good and sometimes won't be. But what about heaven all the time? How would we create that? So here's what I learned from the others. Acceptance. Let's accept new people by meeting them. Adults have elevator consciousness all the time. You walk into church. You sit down. Zone. Oh, the thoughts just went my head. Oh, no. I'm trying to get it out. But isn't it true? How many of you know? I mean, I see it. Do you see it in others? Meet a new person, even if they've been here 20 years. If you don't know them, they're new to you. Meet someone. The teens, I think they set it up, but we're not going to do that. They set it up by having 34 teens and 6 facilitators in a room the size of this. They have to meet each other. Meet someone. That's acceptance. Attend. Attend. Just as they attended because they had to, well, you know what? In some ways, you know you have to. not this church, but A, you need to attend to your connection. You need to attend to creating a posse. It needs attention. If you want a group that will support you, you have to attend to it. That means attending here or somewhere, some other spiritual community, even when you don't want to, because most likely that's when you most need to. Like I had a gentleman after first service say, I love it. Adults, they're so funny. They sneak over. You know, that happened to me. Through the summer, I wasn't feeling so good, but I made myself keep showing up, and I made myself keep showing up, and I've turned a corner, and I don't know what happened, but all I could say was, I've done the same thing. I have to, the days I'm on, I need to be here, but there's times I don't want to be here. There's times I don't want to get in my car and come here until I'm here. And then I wonder why I didn't want to be here. And then the community feeds me, and then I feed it back. We attend. We do. And if your life is going so good, you say to yourself, oh, well, I don't need church today. I've got this guy. Well, maybe somebody needs you. Maybe someone needs to sit by you and get a little bit of your consciousness, because that's what's happening with the teens. You know, some of those teens, they're going through stuff, but their stuff is big, and sometimes it's small. And some teens have wonderful families where the mama and the daddy and the sisters and the brothers show up for them. And some have no mama and daddy. And they're all together, and they all support each other, no matter what's going on. You know, if we're ever going to have a world that works, we have to realize that who we are, especially if we're blessed, is a blessing someone else, whether it's on the bus or at the bus stop or at work or at this place called the Center for Spiritual Living. We're here for each other. We get it all over each other. If life's going good, I want some. So we accept, we attend, and we get involved. We get involved some way, shape, or form, either in classes or the support groups, all the support groups that we have for people. We get involved through volunteering. We just get involved. It's important. To the degree you get involved, to that degree you can evolve through this teaching. But we've become spectators. Guess what? This is the team. Everybody can be on the field. You can be doing something. They won't let you do that at the Seahawks. Yeah. I'm telling you, no matter how much you love them, the insurance would not cover everybody being on the field at the same time. It'd be way too expensive. And if you haven't done it that way, you're not wrong. I'm not wrong. We're not wrong. There is, you know, that's one of the things I love about this. Basic teachings of science mind, nothing's wrong. But some things help us evolve faster than other things. It's just, we're not wrong if we don't pray. But you're going to connect to your God sooner and more permanently and deeper if you pray. You're not wrong if you don't meditate. But meditation brings about peace of mind. You're never wrong. We're not wrong. I'm just sharing with you what I know would work, because I see it every year at CBEC, because young people are doing it. And I want that for all of us. So let's go back to the science mind. Basic ideas of the science mind. He could have also said basic ideas of infinite intelligence that operates through all form and activity, and is the pattern through which matter and energy interact. He could have said that, but it's shorter to just say mind. Because when we say mind, some of us now think of mind as my mind or your mind. And really, he's talking about an infinite intelligence that our mind happens to operate through. It's bigger than my mind and your mind. It's mind. It's intelligence. It's vast. It is It is that which coordinates the activity of the metabolism in your cells. And it also coordinates the migration of birds and butterflies. I mean, it's huge. Our mind, which is, by the way, not in our head, it's bigger than our head. You guys know that, right? Otherwise, people couldn't have near-death experiences. We couldn't have deja vu experiences. We couldn't imagine what's happening over there, and it is happening over there. We couldn't go outside this body if it was in our body. Our body happens to be in our mind, in intelligence. So, I love that part. Vast. We're vast. I was thinking about if it was just contained within this thing that's called gray matter. Think of butterflies. If they have a brain, how tiny that would be. And yet they know when to pick up and decide to travel 3,000 miles. And they get there. That they're riding intelligence. They are being coordinated by something that knows how to coordinate everything. And that's mind. So what I want to talk about is the three basic principles of this mind. Like, there are three colors that come together for color therapy, in color therapy. If you've got red and blue and yellow, you can do just about anything if you know how to bring them together. Well, you can do just about anything if you know how to get back to the basics of this. I think sometimes I will talk about things, and everything I'm talking about really is about using these three concepts, these three core concepts, which is how mind works. First of all, we believe that the mind, which is one, operates in three distinct areas in three distinct ways. One is the conscious mind makes decisions. It directs. Conscious mind has volition and choice. Now, you're listening to me and you think you're conscious. Most of us think we're conscious. Except every time you do something and you wonder, why did I do that? You weren't conscious. And every time you can't stop doing things you wish you could stop doing, you're not conscious. And every time you end up somewhere like work and you don't know how you got there, you weren't conscious. It's not bad. Isn't it great? I mean, who'd want to direct that car? How many of you ever remember when you started to drive? It took a lot of concentration, especially if it was a stick. I could, off the gas, on, oh, wow, then the brake. Anybody remember that? Oh, man. And then something happened, and it became subjective, which is another way that the intelligence works. You make some conscious decisions, you learn something consciously, and then you can kind of give it up. You learn it, and then it's done. We don't think about walking anymore, unless we've had to relearn walking. But I bet we thought about it a lot when we were learning to walk. Does that make sense? So when you're learning something new, you have to consciously move all the levers, and then what you've learned becomes subjective, and it just happens. That's why you can think of all sorts of things on the way to work, and then you're at work. Or all sorts of things on the way to a friend's house, and then you're at a friend's house, because it's all been subjective. Subjective means it's subject to conscious mind. It is the creative medium. It obeys what it has been told. So conscious mind directs, subjective mind creates. And then mind takes form because there's only mind. It's intelligence, it is matter, and it is energy. And when it becomes solid, it becomes our physical universe. It's still mind, it's still intelligent. And it is that which has been created. It is conditions and experiences. So an idea happens, plomp, into the subjective, which is going to make it happen, plop, evidence, results, so on and so forth. Seems easy, doesn't it? Yeah, right. Easy breezy, if only it were. The problem that happens is we're told this, and sometimes we go out and try to work with that idea, and it doesn't turn out like we thought it would. Many years ago, the law of attraction got really popular, which I find is a very shallow explanation of a very complex universe, because there's so much more going on. If everybody could think of something and immediately attract it, we would have no more debt, we'd have no more bad relationships, everyone would have the car they want, they couldn't even create Teslas fast enough. We'd certainly have no war, because unless you're an arms dealer, you're not dreaming up war every day. We wouldn't have the world we have if that really worked that simply. So how does it work? Here's where we start mixing things together and get complex images, which is where I love to play. It's where it gets exciting. So here's what I believe. What I believe is that so much of us is subjective, that we are living on decisions that were made so long ago, or impressions that we received so long ago, that just because we decide to drop in a new idea, that new idea is overwhelmed by the subjective milieu that already exists. It really shows up when I do workshops or when I do classes with people. They want to have this new thing, but they've got all these ideas about why they can't. So it showed up in the last receiving workshop. I just said, you know, be open, because the universe wants to give to us. Be open to receive. And there were ideas like, I'm not worthy, it would take too much work, it's too late. And there's a big pot of it. A big pot. And so they drop in this idea, and it goes, and the law, which we'll talk about next week, continues to work through the subjective, which is one little blurb, and then blah, 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 blah. I hate having epiphanies at church as I'm talking. But an epiphany came to me at church this morning as I was talking. I was giving this example, and I realized that I was told from the time I was a baby until I moved out of the house and they quit talking to me. In fact, even then they'd tell me this, you're so pleasingly plump. No matter what my weight, I was pleasingly plump. If you're pleasingly plump, it's very hard to see yourself as slim, trim, and fit. And I thought, wow, no wonder. Even when I start to envision myself as something else, I'm up against plumpness. Pleasingly. I can honestly say no man has ever complained. But it doesn't mean I can fit into the clothes I want to fit into. Does that make sense? I was like, oh man, I gotta get rid of pleasingly plump. How about just pleasingly pretty? See, I can't even do it. See that? I'm just in that milieu, that boop, boop. So the boop, boop runs us. How do we get through that? I'm going to share with you some ways that I learned from world religions, because I don't think there was a spiritual master on the earth teaching in any religion that did not recognize this dilemma and try to work people through it so that they could have the lives they wanted. First of all, and this is you've got to realize you can do therapy. There's lots of ways you can do this. You can do therapy. You can take lots of personal growth retreats and so forth. But since you are in a spiritual community, I'm going to give you a spiritual formula for this. It doesn't mean they're wrong or not working or efficient. But having tried those, I think this is more efficient and less wear and tear on the soul. So I don't have to go through hell to get to heaven. So this is the formula. Number one, start to identify with the highest, your highest idea of God. Whatever your highest idea of, identify with it. Seek it out. As you turn to it, it turns to you. It's like you will start to feel more light. Not only luminous, but light. And realize that you're a chip off that old block. And that's very biblical. Let's just use it. That we are created in the image and likeness of God, and yet there had been no image and likeness of God stated. All we knew about God at that time is that it was good and it was creative. So we are in the image and likeness of creative goodness. Creative goodness. And as we start to identify that with that and realize that we're an emanation or expression of that, God created us, he and she, and in God's image, then we get to imagine that if it's true of God, it's true of us. If it's not true of God, it's not true of us. And this is so basic, but it gets back to the same thing all the time. Because nothing, it will be years of therapy to get rid of the idea you're not worthy. And then some. And ideas that you're not good enough, and ideas that it's too late, and ideas that you just have to settle. Those ideas are in there, blub, blub. And they can be eradicated, but with a human effort, it takes a long time. And yet, when we start to accept what is true of God, what is that kind of universal cosmic truth has more power to it than just arguing with ourselves. Instead, we argue about ourselves like, if God is good, then I've got to be good. And then the little thought bubbles up, well, you know you're not. If God's good, I'm good. Yeah, but see? It's a process, but it's an effective process. We've got time. First service, I asked what gets in the way of you accepting something that you want, and one person said it would take too much work, and the other person said, I'm not worthy. So anybody have another reason why, you know, anything bubbling up from the brew that you'd like to not have run your life? What's yours?
Everyone else is stuck that way, too.
Oh, well, we're all stuck. Oh, that's better. We're all stuck together. And what if it doesn't work? If it didn't work, what would happen? No, underneath, whoever said it does, what if it doesn't work? What would happen if it didn't work? What's under that? Yes, an idea of failure. See, one of the reasons why we don't try new things is because we might fail. I mean, I know I'm there. It's one of the reasons I force myself to try new things so that I know that I'm not a failure even if it doesn't taste good. In fact, this is an aside. I made dinner last night for Tim, and it didn't turn out well. And I noticed that all last night I was redoing the recipe. I'd wake up and I said, I could have done that. The meal wasn't good, but I'm not a failure. See, if I started naming myself as a failure, I would A, stop trying, or I'd make sure I failed. Does that make sense? I'm just the evolution of success. Because eventually, I'm going to try that recipe, and it's going to be good. Does that make sense? So we have some new ideas. So in the big scheme of things, looking at the elegance of the universe, not what human beings do to it, but the elegance of the universe, is God a failure? Then I cannot be innately a failure. If I'm a chip off the old block, I was born to succeed at what I try. And I may have to try more than once. No child stand up and goes, "Wah-ha! Look at me!" You know, They get up a few times before they woo-woo-woo. It takes a while. But they were born, and they actually believe they're going to succeed. If they're going to walk, they're going to do it. They may not do it right away. So we were born to succeed at the things we try. And what was the other one? Stuck. Is God, now you have to look at the universe and the way that it is traveling, just the earth around the sun and the moon around the earth and the solar system around the galaxy and the galaxy spinning. Is God stuck? So stuck is our idea. Bloop, bloop, bloop. So the more we contemplate the movement of the universe, the more we will feel like we can move. See the difference, how we start to interpret those things? Spiritual ideas actually have more power than human ideas, but we have to take them in and we have to cultivate them. Another way to move through this is to take classes. I mean, you know, you'd hear, you know, whether it's here or somewhere else or joining a study group or just study spiritual ideas. Just take some ideas and start to study them. All of that's important. Hang out with people that you want to be like. It's all, this is osmosis. People at CBEC, they've got a contagion. Hang with them. People that are starting to believe in themselves, hang out with them. It's contagious. It's contagious. And the last thing is, be of service. We all have so much inside of us, but we don't know what we've got unless we start giving it away. And service means, here's service. It doesn't mean I give and you give back. It's not a bartering system. It's just a free giving. And out of that free giving, you'll discover there's more to you than you think there is. And as long as you're holding back, you are perpetuating the blub, blub, blub of there's nothing important in me to give, or I'm not enough and I can't give. It's just the way that it works. So I realized we were supposed to do a whole thing, weren't we? No wonder the time went so fast. Yeah, let's do it. Let's talk about community. You know, with CBEC was community. I know. Hey, they're all up. You're sitting there. Come on. Hey. Everybody's moving except you, Beverly. Bubbly. We're ready. I know. Look. Okay, I didn't know, I got carried away, I was having fun, but you know, this song is about us coming together. There's the security that comes from a clan, a family unit, and it's good, but it's nothing like a tribe. When we realize that we can be comfortable even with others. And then life gets exciting.
One people living on one planet, joining in one family. We all are one.
Join us.
One people living on one planet, joining in one family. We all are one.
Try that again. One people.
Joining in one family. We
share. We live in a world where somebody cares. Still we sleep through the night, only afraid of the darkness, looking for traces of light, watching for some sign of progress. Wake up, little girl, the future's bright. Wake up, little boy, look through the night and see that one is you and me. One world in harmony
together.
So I'm so grateful for our choir getting everyone involved, and so I just complete this time with this closing prayer. Thank you, sweet spirit, for bringing us together. Thank you, sweet spirit, for teaching us, letting us observe what works and then having the courage to try it on, to move outside of our comfort zone by accepting others and showing up ourselves and engaging in this process called the evolution of life. Thank you, sweet, sweet spirit, for everyone that is here, for each heart, for each breath, for each mind, for each consciousness. I bless it all. And so it is.
Sammy was a God-fearing man. He read his Bible from the palm of his hand, and he went to heaven the moment he died. It's where he saw the light that God belongs to all of us. General knows that God's on his side, but his enemy pray that the evil general die. They thank God when the killing is done. No, God belongs to all of us. All the love is in your heart. chosen are all of us.
All of us. Here we go.
All of us.
Sing with us.
God belongs to all of us.